Hey everybody, and welcome to more of a topical video today, where I'm going to be discussing a couple of the recent podcasts that have been going on in the professional wrestling spectrum here. First of all, CM Punk on the Colt Cabana's podcast, and then of course Vince McMahon on the Stone Cold podcast from this past week's Monday Night Raw, actually after Raw on the WWE Network. It was definitely something worth watching, that's for damn sure. But I want to take a few minutes to talk about each of these podcasts, kind of give you my thoughts. And of course, you know, I'm a professional wrestling fan, I have been for a long time, so you know, take my opinion at face value. I'm a fan, and I have every right to my opinion, as do you guys, for sure. These are, without a doubt, somewhat controversial, I guess you could say, in terms of the whole CM Punk debacle. There's people who believe Punk is a complete sellout, fool, terrible person, whatnot. Some people who revere him as a hero, and then there are people who kind of just fall in the middle, and that's basically where I guess you could say I fall. Look, you know, I don't think CM Punk is the kind of guy where he really, you know, left in a good way. I don't think it takes a genius to realize that CM Punk didn't leave in the best way humanly possible. Of course not. We've seen it before. The Stone Cold case from 02 is a very good example. When you're not getting what you want, sometimes you leave. You have to put yourself in the guy's shoes. I think it's really important to take a look at this from the perspective of Punk as best as you can. Obviously, you aren't Phil Brooks, and you're not going to sit there and say, oh yeah, this is how I feel. No, you are going to sit there, and you're going to be a fan, but you're going to try to think about how it would be if it was you. Think about your own person, your own character, the own push that you might like to have if you were in the company. Now, obviously, you're probably going to think pretty highly of yourself, as CM Punk does. And, you know, a lot of people will view that as arrogance. And there were pieces to the podcast that I felt did come off as arrogant. Like the fact that he wanted to include himself in the Rock Cena main event from WrestleMania 29. Let me tell you the truth. Rock Cena WrestleMania 29 shouldn't have happened, plain and simple. Punk versus one of those guys, fine. But him trying to include himself in that match just kind of made it sound like, what? He didn't really have a place in that match. He should have just never lost the belt and probably just faced Cena one-on-one for it at Mania, but he probably would have just gone on and lost the belt anyway. But I don't know. I just think that some of the things that he wanted versus some of the things that WWE wanted were so far apart that it seemed at sometimes that WWE was actually being a little more realistic. I mean, the guy held the belt for 434 days. To put him in a little bit of a less high spot for a certain period wasn't really the worst thing that they could do. But the things that they were asking of him, like the fact that he just wanted some goddamn time off, and the fact that they kind of tried to rush him back multiple times, just goes to show you the way that, you know, employers love you for what you give them, not for what they give you. Bottom line is, CM Punk was an asset for WWE. And WWE didn't really, frankly, care that much about whether or not Punk was in the best health possible. They know they don't have a lot of top draws. Outside of CM Punk and Daniel Bryan and John Cena, the amount of other guys who draw a big amount of money for that company and sell a lot of merchandise, there aren't a lot of names. And that goes without saying. So I think Punk had a lot of legitimate complaints and legitimate points that he made throughout the two-hour podcast. So let us not forget, you know, CM Punk doesn't owe us an explanation. Nobody, like, I mean, a lot of people love to say, oh, CM Punk owes us an explanation. Well, why? He left his job. He doesn't have to explain himself. If he does explain himself, it definitely makes him look better than if he doesn't. That's for sure. And I actually really appreciate the fact that he took the 2 hours to tell us everything and he's going to answer questions this week. I think that's a great thing on Punk. I think the fact that it took 10 months is maybe a little crazy, but hey, better late than never. And the fact that he did explain and did kind of give us the whys to the reasons. I mean, the reasons were already thrown out there on the dirt sheets a long time before. And really, honestly, the reasons and versus, or in comparison to what Punk actually had to say on this podcast were quite similar. And I think that that's not a surprise at all. But it kind of gives you a little more clearance. I think certain aspects, such as the fact that the doctor wouldn't remove the staph infection or the bulge that ended up becoming a staph infection on his back, that is just crazy to me. The fact that they tried to rush him back from surgery in 2012 with the TLC thing with Ryback, when Ryback actually legit hurt him. I mean, again, like, some of that stuff sounds like complaining from Punk, but some of it also sounds so legit. Put yourself in his position and say to yourself, man, I just had a freaking knee surgery, and they're putting me back in 2 weeks. But then again, it's like, this is the job. This is the way it is. So you can kind of see it from both sides. It's like, this is the job. This is the culture of professional wrestling in WWE. And as Punk himself said, it is the only game in town. The only real game in town, that's for damn sure. So, I wanted to kind of talk about the Triple H, the whole Triple H thing. Punk was supposed to face Triple H at WrestleMania. And, you know, he said that Triple H needed to wrestle him and whatnot. Well, let me say this much. I don't think either guy needed either guy, because Triple H still put on an awesome match with Daniel Bryan. And WrestleMania was a great show. Actually, I think Punk leaving helped Daniel Bryan to solidify Daniel Bryan as the guy who ended up getting the main event spot at WrestleMania and winning the belt. I mean, I'm sure there's got to be a little bit of jealousy within Punk to say, man, Daniel Bryan already main evented WrestleMania, and I never did. Hell, Daniel Bryan did double duty at WrestleMania this year, and it was awesome. Look, I think Punk deserved to main event WrestleMania. I really do. But I think at the same time, it's like, you know, that's only one match. There's only one match that can main event a card. And Punk wasn't really in a position to be at the main event this year. Maybe he would have been next year. But I can see why frustration builds up so much over 2-3 years of this. And I'm happy that CM Punk is happy. I'm glad the guy's happy, because he's always been one of my favorites. He's been one of my favorites since before he even debuted. I mean, the guy is absolutely a great talent. He honestly could work really well as both a heel and a face. And he was really fun to watch in the ring. Cut some great promos. Had some great times. And damn, I really do hope he comes back someday. And some people will say that CM Punk coming back would be be detrimental or terrible for wrestling. Dude, you gotta be kidding me. CM Punk coming back would be probably the best thing that could happen right now, because it would generate a lot of interest in the product, which hasn't been that interesting at times as of late. So it would generate a lot of interest. And that interest that it would generate is a great thing. So CM Punk coming back would be awesome. Well, let's not lie about that, whether you like or hate the guy. I know it's hard when you don't like somebody, a talent, whether it's Punk or whoever, and they're getting the push, and the big push, you're saying to yourself, but why? Why are they getting the push? It's not good. And you come up with a bunch of reasons in your mind why it's not good. But the thing is, if it generates a lot of money, puts a lot of butts in seats, and gives the product a better overall rating, higher merchandise sales, whatnot, then it's a good thing. It's a good thing for business. So anyway, bottom line is, I enjoyed this podcast. I think it is something that everybody should view. It's, yes, 2 hours. You know, you don't have to view all 2 hours at once. I'm not going to tell you how long you should watch or watch it in parts, whatever. I watched it all in one sitting because it was really great and entertaining, and I enjoyed every second of it. Oh, I probably will listen to it a second time through because it was that enjoyable for me. I think it was a great thing to hear Punk finally just getting out there. I think that's what it was more than anything else, and kind of getting some of the reasoning behind what was going on. I will say, you can't not laugh at the fact that Punk blocked WWE on Twitter while he was still working for them. I think that's funny. But damn it, man, the fact that they fired him on his wedding day. His birthday is in October. I'm not even thinking. But, you know, that's a little bit of a low blow. They knew what they were doing. But, you know, that's WWE for you, kind of just giving it right back to him. I thought it was interesting to hear a lot more in-depth in terms of the talks between him, Vince, and Triple H, and that Vince was, you know, on the verge of tears because he didn't want to see Punk leave. I totally believe that. I believe a lot of what Punk said, to be completely honest. I think it's really, you know, easy to say, you know, oh, I don't believe this, I don't believe that. Yeah. I can understand that to a certain degree, but I think that a lot of what Punk said was truth, because I don't think he has anything to hide or hold back anymore. What is there left to hide? I mean, why would you lie? I think he may have embellished on some of the things and may have, you know, pushed and pulled to make them kind of seem like you would want to take his side. And I wasn't really thinking of the right words here. But anyway, you know what I'm trying to say here. I wouldn't be surprised if he kind of, you know, packaged it a certain way. whether he did or not is, you know, to you know, the listeners here, it's kind of hard as hell, to be completely honest with you. But I do think it's important to remember that there's always two sides to a story. That's a very important thing to remember, and I know that's becoming like a tagline here, but there is two sides to every story, and it should be always noted that there are two sides to a story, because you'd like to hear more from WWE. And yes, Vince McMahon addressed it in the podcast, but getting more of the in-depth of the rebuttal would be a good thing. And I know that Punk mentioned multiple times throughout the podcast that, you know, he wasn't burying WWE, and this wasn't I'm going to dump on WWE kind of podcast, but it was. Like, it's like saying it without saying it. You're saying you're not, but you were doing it. It's hard not to. I mean, I know he wasn't trying to, but again, he was. And bottom line, that's not a bad thing, to dump on the company that treated you like crap for 3 years, to be honest with the way things were and how you were mistreated and things were on a slant. And you were on the bottom edge of that. You know, I mean, the guy had to work really hard just to get to where he got. So he has a thick skin and a hard shell, and he might come off as arrogant and smug, but he's had to work twice as hard as a John Cena to get even, you know, some of what Cena has gotten. So I think I have a lot of respect for Punk. I really always have. I respect him a lot. I don't think he's a hero for leaving. I'm not going to be like, oh, praise Punk because he left a job that wasn't good. Anybody who's anybody should do that. When you're in a workplace or in a situation where something is bad and you aren't liking it and it's annoying and you know, fuck this place, leave. Leave. No one is forcing you to stay at all. Bottom line, you got to leave something that you're not happy with. Life's all about making yourself happy. And you have to do things that are best for you sometimes. I understand it might have come off as selfish for Punk to leave, and I can see why it does. I think it is selfish. But I don't think being selfish is always a terrible thing. That's a common misconception, I feel like, is that everybody just assumes selfishness equals terrifying, awful quality. But you feed yourself every day, and you wake up, and you are always going out and doing stuff for your own self as well as you are for others. To help others is really important, but you cannot help others unless you help yourself. Don't forget that. That's more of a life thing than anything else, but it relates to this situation. So I think this Punk Colt Cabana podcast was great. Really good listen. I recommend it to any and everyone. I really do. Anybody who's a wrestling fan, great, great listen. So to kind of go over the Stone Cold podcast, kind of just segue into the whole Vince talking about CM Punk thing, him wanting him back at some point in time, hoping they can work something out. Hey, I hope so too, Vince. I think him apologizing was really appropriate. I think he did owe Punk an apology, definitely. And I think Vince carried himself really well during this entire Stone Cold podcast. I think Stone Cold did a great job of asking the real good questions. I think Vince is a really smart individual. He always has been. And he's always done what he has felt is best. He has always stuck by his values. Now, whether those values are something that the majority of fans agree with or not is a whole other ballgame. But I think that Vince McMahon is a really respectable guy because of the fact that he's always stuck to his values. Now, I don't always agree with his values, and I know a lot of people don't agree with his values. And I think that the easiest thing to disagree with in this entire podcast was the very fact that he claims to still be so in touch with the fans. And it's a very common thing to see in the IWC and through a lot of fans who are very critical of the product, myself included, that he doesn't seem to be so in touch with the fans anymore. I think that he just thinks that he knows what everyone wants because he has known what everyone's wanted in the past a lot. He knew enough to what people wanted to beat the rival company and put on the best product in history. I mean, WWE is the best company of all time, and there's a reason why it's at the top. It's a really, really important reason, and Vincent Kennedy McMahon is really 95% of it. His dad started the ship, but my God, is he sped up into first place, and he has just blazed a path that I don't know if anybody can ever touch in this industry again. So, again, Vince McMahon is a well-respected guy, of course. But it's really, you know, tough for me to sit there and say he's really in touch with the modern-day fan when they even brought up the fact that people's attention spans are shorter now in the 21st century, in this decade, in this age of smartphones and computers and technology and you know, snap of your fingers, you got everything you want kind of world that we live in now. Is it good and bad? That's for another debate. But to put on a 3-hour product every week, and you could tell Stone Cold was kind of trying to twist the screws just a little bit and kind of say like, hey, you know, this 3-hour stuff, it, even for me, I'm like, whew, you know, 3 hours of sitting there watching this product, it's too much for the fans. And that is a quick segue for me to say, I'm going to be doing a video series where I talk about WWE Reform. Episode 1 is going to be all about 3 hours is too long. To think that a 3-hour product is something that Vince McMahon tries to say is within the touch of the current fan is just absolutely ridiculous. I mean, I like that he conceded that other people are going to be watching football and whatnot, but why don't you just put your product from 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. and then put in there more, the more important pieces, and then leave some of the other important pieces for your Friday night show, which is still supposed to be important, but otherwise feels unneeded because of the fact that so much stuff is thrown on Raw and there's nothing left for SmackDown. And the stuff that is thrown on Raw is not as good as you want it to be. So I think with him being in touch with the fans, it was kind of a head-scratcher, because I think that a lot of people disagree with that, especially right now. Again, Vince McMahon has been so in touch with the fans in the past that I think that he doesn't take the time to listen to what fans are talking about anymore. It's in one ear and out the other now. And you can see the look on his face even during the podcast, kind of be like, I don't want to hear it. I mean, I'm not saying if I was Vince McMahon, maybe I wouldn't want to hear it either. But you have to say to yourself, man, you got to listen a little better right now, today. In the past, he did listen. But that's because he had to win the war. And when you have to win the war, you will do whatever you've got to do to win the war. He was a desperate man, and he did desperate things. And those desperate things are the best things that have ever happened in professional wrestling. And he took those risks. And that's why Vince McMahon is so well-respected, because he has that ability. He has done it. He's proven it. But it's become somewhat of a more complacent product over the course of the years. And he's not as in touch with what the fans want, because the fans want other things than what they're getting. And a great example of this is the fact that he says Cesaro doesn't have the it factor. I'm sorry, Vince. I'm sorry, WWE. But Cesaro is everything that you want in a wrestler. He has all the qualities, maybe minus the fact that he isn't the best talker of all time. Put a mouthpiece on him, psh, we're done. Good. You had Heyman on him, but, you know, that, of course, was gone a little sooner than it should have been. Now, I agree with Stone Cold in that it was really easy to get behind Cesaro for a while, and then they turn him with Heyman, and kind of turning him back into a heel was kind of a bad move, actually, because Cesaro was gaining momentum as a babyface because of the fact that his swing was over. His strength is something that is just awesome to watch. His in-ring prowess is great. His ability to tell a story in the ring is great. His entrance is great. His look is fucking perfect. I mean, what else do you want out of this guy? And you're going to tell me that Bray Wyatt has the it factor over Cesaro, when really the only thing that Bray Wyatt outdoes Cesaro in my opinion, is talking. Talking, Bray Wyatt blows him away. But in terms of look, in terms of, obviously, physique. I mean, again, I like Bray Wyatt's physique because it's different. And I like guys that don't have to look traditional and yet can still be big stars, because that is huge in wrestling. There shouldn't be a certain mold of a superstar. I think that's dumb. But Cesaro has the mold that Vince and the guys and Triple H and them, that he has the look that those guys are looking for all the time. And yet you're not going to give him the push. I just cannot believe that you finally have a guy who looks like any other big guy, but yet wrestles like he's 5'10" and weighs 190, except with strength. Super damn strength. The guy is the best talent you've got on this roster. And I have this horrifying feeling in the back of my mind that he's just going to end up being another guy that gets released. And unfortunately, he's going to be a guy in a couple years that everyone's talking about as the guy who got away from WWE and the guy who flat out never got what he deserved. We're talking about guys like Drew McIntyre in that category, and Cesaro very well may join that party. And I don't want that to happen for that guy. He has world champion written all over him. He could be the guy that takes down Brock Lesnar. He's believable already. Just the pure strength alone would be amazing. To see him swinging Brock Lesnar around, winning the Royal Rumble this year. But he's not even in a close position to do that. And if he did, it would kind of be like, what? But hell, I wouldn't complain if it happened. But I completely disagree with Vince McMahon in terms of Cesaro not having the it factor, especially in comparison to a Bray Wyatt, who I am a big fan of, and I am a huge endorser of Bray Wyatt's character and the gimmick. I think they have completely screwed it up. It's funny that a guy who he thinks has the it factor, they still have fucked storylines up with and made him feel less relevant than Cesaro. Like, again, some huge hypocrisies and holes in the thinking here. In the processing. And this is some on the writers and some on the company and the and Vince and, you know, whatever. It's on a bunch of people. It's not just one guy who screws everything up. It is a bunch of ideas put together that just never worked out. And they're worried about Cesaro not being over enough. The guy was getting cheered out the building every time he would put the swing on, the whole crowd was standing up. So don't tell me that Cesaro isn't over. That's bullshit. You give him a run as a babyface, let him go and swing people around. You don't even need to throw a manager on him at that point. He doesn't have to say a whole lot, and yet it'll be okay. He can be a world champion, 100%. 100% a world champion look, a world champion ability. This guy is a talent that you rarely are going to find. And you're going to tell me that a Roman Reigns is better because of a bloodline? Don't even start. Anyway, I didn't even have to mention Roman Reigns any other time. I know he's the golden child that everyone wants to see. Not everybody is a fan, but everybody in WWE wants to see become world champion. I have no interest in it. Look, Roman Reigns, A, no moveset at all. B, can't talk that great. C, has a great look. That's the one thing. And D, is nowhere near ready in terms of what he's already done and accomplished. Winning a Royal Rumble and becoming world champion. You might as well have a Cesaro win at this point. Anyway, enough about that stuff. I just disagree with some of the stuff that McMahon was saying. But again, like I said from the very get-go, I respect the guy for sticking to his values. He always sticks to his guns, and that's a good and a bad thing. Obviously, good thing, when he sticks to his guns, he knows what to do at the right times. But bad at times because he lets talents get bypassed because he doesn't think they have all the factors that they need. But dude, you gotta just take a risk on some things, and I think that Cesaro's the guy to throw that out with. Anyway, I thought it was also cool, one last thing that was awesome, was the fact that he talked about the streak ending, and, you know, his decision to have it end, and The Undertaker's graciousness, and whatnot. I did kind of shake my head a little bit at the fact that he wanted to make Brock Lesnar a bigger star, when you could have just made the bigger star from him directly beating The Undertaker rather than having a guy well established like Brock Lesnar beat The Undertaker. Although I will say, in storyline, in terms of what makes sense, Brock Lesnar, I said this back in my WrestleMania review, I've kept this view from day one, but if you go based off of what makes sense and what seems the most realistic, Brock Lesnar would beat The Undertaker at WrestleMania. He is the guy, in a way. Obviously, I wish it was, like, at a different time in space and whatnot, and Lesnar wasn't a part-timer and all that. But I do think that, you know, it's important to say, Brock Lesnar, UFC heavyweight champion, really, really legit tough guy. And him beating a 40-some-odd-year-old Undertaker at WrestleMania makes sense. It really does. It makes sense, but it's just so shocking that it happened, and he wasn't really that guy to do it because he wanted a more young talent with a lot more time left in his career. But again, as people will say, and I don't disagree with this, the guy who beats Lesnar basically is the guy who beat the guy who beat the streak. So, in other words, you know, that guy will get a huge rub, and not only that, but we'll win the title, and we're thinking it's going to be Roman Reigns. But Cesaro makes more sense if you go based off of who would really beat Brock Lesnar. I think Cesaro would hold a much better shot against Brock Lesnar in a legit fight than I do Roman Reigns. But that's just my opinion. Anyway, not important enough. I think that the bottom line here is, no pun intended, Stone Cold puts out a great podcast. Listen to a couple of his with Paul Heyman. They're excellent to listen to. If you missed this, make sure you listen to it. Also, great for the WWE Network. This is the kind of content on WWE Network that will garner more subscriptions. Awesome choice by WWE to air this live on the network. Great job. And I like that they were breaking the fourth wall. I'm glad that, because everybody knows, okay, at this point in time, keep the kayfabe on television and having an after show where they talk about legit stuff. It isn't a bad thing. That's a good thing. If anything, it's just going to generate more interest in your network overall. More people will tune in if they're going to get a podcast where Vince gives his legit thoughts on stuff. They're going to tune in. Guaranteed. Anyway, that's it for this one. I think 25 minutes is long enough to talk about a couple of podcasts and a lot of big thoughts and big, you know, occurrences over the course of this last week or two. So bottom line here for me is I really respect Vince for even going on this podcast and going out there and saying how he feels about stuff, whether we agree or not. He sticks to his guns. I agree. The same thing goes for CM Punk. They stick to their guns. They're honest. And they go, you know, and they say how they feel. And I think that's a good thing. And I like these podcasts. They were really great to listen to. This is kind of the age of the podcast. And it's awesome in a way. Anyway, so that's going to do it for me for this video. Now, if you guys have any other additional questions that you would like me to have answered, be sure to leave them in the comment section. And I will address those. Like questions in terms of like things I didn't cover. I know I didn't cover every aspect of the Punk podcast and every aspect of the Vince Stone Cold podcast, because that would just take too damn long. So any other like questions or things that are you wonder what my view is on, just go ahead and ask me down below in the comments. Be sure to give me a like if you enjoyed the video as well, if you agree with any of my viewpoints, and not even just if you agree, but if you feel that that these podcasts are a good thing going forward and that they did a good service for the WWE Network. And not only that, but just the fact that in general, it was great to hear some legitimate thoughts from Punk, from McMahon, whether you love him or hate him. So, regardless, good stuff to listen to. I highly recommend it to anyone who hasn't listened, and to those who did, give me your thoughts, of course, in the comments. Be sure to subscribe for plenty more to come. As I mentioned in my Raw review from this past week, go ahead and stay tuned for a Saturday WWE Reform Episode 1 video where I talk about the 3-hour format and how it needs a bad change, a big change, an enormous change. Anyway, that's going to be a series going for me every couple of weeks, but I'll give you more details on that video date, which will be Saturday. After that, Raw review on Monday, and then we've got the Q&A finally coming out Wednesday, and then TLC predictions and a review over the weekend, next weekend. Man, time is flying by. It's already December. That's crazy. Anyway, thanks as always for taking the time to watch. Really appreciate it, guys. Like I said, like, comment, subscribe, and stay tuned for plenty more. So it was a pleasure, as always, to give you a brand new video here, a thoughts video. I wish I could do these more often. I intend to over my winter break and whatnot. So plenty more to come. Thanks as always for watching, and until next time, peace out.